just wondered whether we are mixing up history with myths, because a lot of what you know about Jesus and then the subsequent events may not be part of history but part of the myth.
For you. But ask a well-informed Christian theologian, are you willing to accept Jesus as myth? You see, we project ourselves because we are able to deal with it comfortably. The reason for historicity has to do with man having original sin, which cannot be redeemed. We are incapable of solving that problem as human beings. There is no reincarnation. You have one life. You're born a sinner, and you cannot solve the problem on your own. You can pray. You can do what you want. Until God comes, takes an incarnation through virgin birth, so He is not Himself a sinner, and through that only He can suffer for you. So God came and suffered for you on the cross. This piece of history, if it is myth, it means that there is no redemption from sin possible today. This cannot be myth. This is the Christian doctrine. And if you want to search under Nicene Creed, N-I-C-E-N-E, Creed, C-R-E-E-D. We need to understand somebody else. In Purva Paksha, I understand somebody according to their doctrine, not according to what I think they ought to believe. That's not Purva Paksha. Purva Paksha means I start by listening to him, saying, you please explain to me what is your belief. And then only I can respond to it. And the Christian belief in Nicene Creed is a requirement. You look at Methodist, Baptist, Catholic, you look at various major denominations, maybe some on the margins are different, but you look at major denominations of Christianity and you look at their websites, and there you have a search, so you put in Nicene Creed, they'll tell you the Nicene Creed is all literal history, no myth allowed there, literal history as a requirement for membership. So you can keep thinking it's all myth, but then you are, it's not Christianity, it is your idea of Christianity.
I'm sorry, I think I got, I could explain a little further.
Sure.
Jesus could be a part of the historicity that we are talking of.
Yes.
But the concepts that we explain, that comes subsequently after Jesus, perpetrated either by the church or by the Islamic community, where they have their own ideology, they could be part of the ideological warfare as a result of the myths that have been incorporated somehow into the historicity.
Give me an example of what you would consider a Christian myth, and I will tell you, let's ask a Christian whether he's willing to call it a Christian myth. Because you see, you are so comfortable. The part of the book you should read is called Itihas versus History. I describe this point. I use Itihas and contrast it with history. And I use Itihas as this, not the same thing as history. Itihas is a different meaning which is more flexible and not linear. Many parallel stories could be going on and different things could be happening. We can accept all of them. And Itihas is flexible in the sense that we can adapt it and update it for the present context and reinterpret the past in the present context. But history, the word comes from his story. His is God. It is God's story. That is how the word, the etymology of the word history, it comes from. And that is a literal event. You see, you must understand that in our tradition, man is Satchitanand, means he is God, he is one with Brahman. So we have no infinite gap between us and Brahman, because Brahman is all-pervading. So we are intimately with Brahman. But in the Abrahamic religions, the starting point is different. God is infinitely removed from the cosmos and infinitely removed from individual souls. That infinite gap, it is not available for souls to evolve and tune in and download that information. It only gets transmitted when God transmits it through a prophet. He has stopped doing that centuries ago. He used to do it, he sent a sequence of prophets, and that's like release one, then release two, then release three, then release four. And he stopped doing it. And your only recourse is to find that history of that particular release, which only the institution claims to have, and you better get it from this institution. Otherwise, on your own, there is no way you can tune in and download it from God's website, because He doesn't do it that way. So this is the issue with historicentrism as a linear sequence of releases that come from God through various prophets, which has ended. No more releases are coming. Either in Christianity, that's final, or in Islam, that's final. So you, the average person, got no direct access. If you bypass, in the case of Islam, somebody says, I don't want anything to do with the Prophet, but I want to be a good Muslim, it's a contradiction. You cannot do that. If in the case of Christianity you say, I'll download this from God by doing some meditation and become a Rishi and get it, this is our way of thinking. But it's alien to them, it's not allowed, you are just deluding yourself, and you go to hell because this is not even possible. So the possibility of somebody who says, Tattvamasi, I am that, yeah, Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman, the possibility exists that I can have that experience, which means that according to our way of looking, that knowledge which the Rishis gave us, Shruti we call it, is downloadable by everybody. Everybody. You just have to clean your act, evolve to a certain point, and then you can tune in. But if another ideology is based not on the idea that the self is Satchitanand, but an infinite gap between the self and God, permanent, never bridged gap, then you are a slave of history. That is the notion of historicentrism that I'm talking about in this book.